Hello, and welcome back to the Very Real Estate Effect podcast, a show dedicated to real estate investing right here in Quebec. And today I'm very pleased to have Dave Dubeau, aka known as the gentleman who helps investors set up processes to raise capital. Is that a fair description?
That's a fantastic description. Thank you very much, Axel.
All right. Well, look, I'm really happy to have you on today. You've already helped a lot of people debunk some of the myth about growing as an investor and not being limited by one's resources and tapping into other people's money. So today we're just going to focus on that because that's a topic that I get a lot more questions about. So I'm actually glad to have you as the expert on the show today.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. And I have to apologize to many of your viewers and your listeners. If you take a look at my name, you're obviously going to think I'm French-Canadian, which I am by blood, 75%. However, my French is horrendous, so I won't even go there.
Well, hey, you're in luck because this is an English podcast.
Thank goodness. Yeah, we'd be both in trouble if it wasn't.
But it's funny you mentioned that because the first time I saw your name, I was like, oh, I wonder how long ago he left Quebec.
200 years.
Yeah, exactly. So there, point made. All right. And I was going to say enough of that. So before we go into, you've developed a formula to help investors raise capital in an easier way than some others might predict. But before we get there, I'd just like to take 2 to 3 minutes for you to explain how you got there. Why did you do that? How did you start in real estate?
Yeah, well, thanks very much, Axel. So like I say, I'm a BC boy from a small town in northern British Columbia. And after I got into university and got out of university with a basically useless degree in psychology, nobody was offering me big jobs. So I thought I'll go travel, see the world a bit. Did that, traveled around Mexico and Central America for a couple of years. Ended up in San Jose, Costa Rica. Fell in love with the place, fell in love with a person there, and decided to plant my flag and said, hey, here I am. I think I was 24 years old, absolutely clueless. I had about $1,000 to my name. Why don't I settle down here and start a business? How tough could it be?
Hey,
so I don't know.
You were young and ignorant.
Exactly. I didn't know any better. Made a good go of it. Got married, had kids there, had a good life, lived there for 10 years. And then once our oldest daughter got towards school age, we decided, hey, you know what? I think Canada would be a better place to raise our kids because being the pasty-faced white dude that I am, whether you have money or not, when you're living in Latin America, people assume that you do. There's a bit of a target on you and your family's back. So, Costa Rica is pretty safe, but still I know a few people that have been kidnapped and held for ransom and that kind of stuff. Doesn't hardly ever happen in Kamloops. So, so we packed up, moved back to Canada. And then the question was, okay, what the heck am I going to do? I've been out of the country so long, Axel. I didn't have bad credit. I had zero credit.
You didn't even exist.
I didn't even exist. Well, they had my sin, but that was about it.
Yeah.
I had been self-employed so long. I was pretty much unemployable. And I didn't have very much money because I hadn't been able to sell my business in Costa Rica. So it was like, what do we do now? So I saw one of those late night infomercials. You're probably too young to remember these, but
I remember.
You too can get rich in real estate with little or no money down. So I said, good, that's what I've got. So I sent away for this program, got this American Guru's Get Rich Quick in Real Estate program, dusted it off, and had to Canadianize it a bit, but did 18 deals in 18 months in and around the fairly small city of Kamloops. So that got me started with real estate investing. I caught the eye of an up-and-coming real estate investor guru guy, kind of a Canadian version of Rich Dad, and went on board with him as the director of marketing for his companies and helped him blow that up to, 7 branch offices, 120-some employees, $200 million a year in revenues, this kind of stuff. So it got pretty big pretty fast.
Yeah.
So I took some time off from real estate investing, but then I got back into it in about 2010. And at that time, I went from doing the low money, no money down type deals to doing single family homes, tenant first rent to own. So we had buy a person a house and then we'd get them in it and then we'd lease option it to them for 2 to 3 years while we helped them get qualified for financing. Mm-hmm. So I did like a lot of people do, Alex. I self-financed my first two properties.
Yeah.
And then I promptly hit the wall, ran out of cash, ran out of credit. And of course, that's when the perfect deal lands in your lap, right?
And then you have 3 weeks to find $500,000.
That's right. Well, it wasn't quite that much because it was a single, well, maybe these days, maybe, but back in those days, the properties were looking at about $400,000. So I needed $100,000 for the down payment, closing costs, property transfer taxes, etc. And I can remember, I don't know if you've ever heard this saying, just find a good deal and the money will find you.
So have you heard that? I've heard that. And I thought it was true.
So did I.
Yeah.
So did I. But I knew, okay, it's not just, you know, even though I read the book, The Secret, it's not going to magically fall out of the sky. So I'd also heard, you know what, if you want to raise money, you got to be like that Wolf of Wall Street kind of guy. You got to pick up the phone and start dialing for dollars. So I tried that and I picked up the phone, dialed, rejected, wasn't feeling very wolfy, dialed, rejected again. And I'm embarrassed to say, Axel, I'd love to be able to say, you know, I cranked through 100 calls and I raised the money I needed. No, I cranked through about 9 or 10 calls,
yeah.
Got rejected every time, didn't raise a damn thing, got pouty and no. Quit calling because my poor little ego couldn't take that much rejection.
Well, that doesn't work.
Yeah, well, yeah, and I don't want to do this anymore.
Yeah.
So then I also remember saying, okay, well, you know what? When you got a deal, go out and turn every conversation into a real estate conversation. Have you heard that one too?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what I did. I grabbed my put on my blazer, grabbed my briefcase, and my handful of business cards, went to the Chamber of Commerce and BNI and Toastmasters, wherever they let me in the door. Because again, I'm times of the essence. And I'm practicing my 30-second commercial on people and networking and schmoozing and that resulted in absolutely zero capital raised as well. And 2020 hindsight, I think I can see why. I was just too damn desperate, right? It just oozed out of every pore in my body. Then now we're 2 weeks, just about 2 weeks in. I have to get a 1 week extension because I only had 2 weeks to remove subjects on that property. And I got a 1 week extension. I'm stressed out over the weekend. Then I came up with what I thought was a brilliant idea. I said, hey, you know what? If enough people see this deal, it'll just naturally sell itself. I mean, it's a good deal. And I had it structured in a way I thought it would be attractive for an investor. So I put my mind to work and I came up with a list of about 200 people that I knew. And I emailed them all this one-page deal overview, right? And thought, oh, this is going to do the trick. And you know what? It started getting me some traction. I actually started getting some response to this, Axel. And I was really excited about it until I started reading the responses, the emails that were coming back.
Uh-oh.
Basically, people were saying, hey, Dave, dude, I haven't heard anything from you in 5 years. One guy hadn't heard anything from me in 18 years. And here you are hit me up for cash.
You can't email the guy and asking for money. Like, no.
Well, thanks for telling me that now, buddy. I mean, at the time, I thought it was a brilliant idea. I mean, 2020 hindsight, yeah, it was a freaking stupid idea.
You tried.
Live and learn. So what happened was very, very painful on a couple of fronts. So first of all, I had to back out of that deal. And that caused, because I'm in a small town, so there was some pretty big egg on my face. Obviously, my tenant buyer was some ticked off.
Yeah.
Obviously, and I had to return there. I think they put $8,000 or $10,000 down as an earnest money deposit. That all went back to them. The seller was some ticked off. The realtor was super ticked off. Mortgage broker was ticked off. Yeah. Everybody was ticked off. And not only that, but because I'd been so clumsy about how I was trying to raise capital, I turned off a lot of really good prospective investors. And so after I drank some beer and drowned my sorrows for a little while and just kind of gave my head a shake, I thought, there's got to be a better way to do this. And I said, okay, first of all, now I know I never want to be in this position again. I never want to be thinking that just find a deal, the money will magically find you. BS. That's you cannot.
And you don't want to be the beggar because you're not the beggar.
You just come across as desperate.
Yeah.
And the second thing is, I'm not naturally inclined to dial for dollars, network, schmooze, all this kind of stuff. why don't I apply some marketing and try and turn it around? So I had a lot of experience with marketing, getting people to put up their hand and self-identify for one thing or another. Why don't I do the same thing when it comes to finding investors? Why don't I see if I can get the word out and get people to come to me about my deals? People coming to me that are already pre-educated, ideally pre-qualified, predisposed, and pre-motivated to invest. That would be the magic potion, wouldn't it? So then by hook and by crook and through trial and error, I came up with this thing behind me, which I call the 5-step money partner formula, which if you'd like to, I'd be happy to kind of give you a big 30,000. Well,
absolutely. And again, like there's a lot of questions about that. Like how do I helped a guy just recently buy a triplex. He'd love to buy another one. He doesn't want to wait 5 years. So how can he do it?
Yeah, definitely. So, again, lots of ways to skin a cat. My preferred way is this, obviously. I came up with this idea. So, and what I found is it works really, really well for a lot of mom and pop real estate investors that are just getting started with raising capital. Because first of all, we got to think a couple of things. A lot of people, when they first want to start raising money, they think anybody with a pulse and a checkbook could be a good investor, right? And on the surface, that sounds good. So they go out and they network up a storm. They spam everybody they know on Facebook. They go shout it from the rooftops, right? And they kind of go out to the general public saying, hey, I got a deal. Are you interested in investing? And that's a big mistake on two levels, Axel. Level number one is common sense, right? Because chances are, especially if you're in Canada, you're going to need at least $100,000 for a down payment to do any kind of a deal. Would that be fair to say?
Yes.
Yeah, at least. All right.
At least, right. Right now, depending on what kind of property you're looking at, like it's a minimum.
Yeah. And what I recommend to people is that they have their minimum investment from an investor partner be $100,000. So in order for somebody to invest $100,000 or more with you, they're going to need to know you, like you, and trust you with their $100,000. Now, if we go into strangers, they don't know you, they don't like you, and they sure as hell do not trust you with $100,000. So that's starting from scratch. That's moving a big rock up a very steep hill. Now, the second big challenge there, Axel, is legalities. And caveat here, I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a security specialist. I'm a real estate guy and a marketer. I'm just sharing my understanding. But my understanding is you and I are not legally allowed to raise capital from the general public.
That's right.
Unless we've got a license to do so. So you're like a stockbroker or a financial planner, maybe a mortgage broker. I'm not even sure what the rules are in Quebec, but I'm sure it's probably pretty similar, if not even more strict. Or you get something called an offering memorandum, which tends to be very, very expensive and really just for much bigger deals. Mm-hmm. Or you set up a corporate structure where you've got exemptions and this kind of thing. So that's beyond the scope of most of us, especially your friend that just wants to get another triplex, right? You don't want to spend $25,000 getting all the legalities set up to go out and fail trying to raise capital from the general public. So where does that leave us? Well, that leaves us with reaching out to people who already know us and ideally already like us. And then all we really need to work on is getting them to trust us with their money to do a real estate deal. So who is that group? That group is friends, family, coworkers, business associates, people that you know from church, from civic organizations, sports groups, whatever, kids' school. You know them, they know you. Now, the first part of this whole process is let's come up with a list of about 100 of these people. I call this not 100 to 200 of these people, ideally around 200. So the dream 200. These are people that you have that pre-existing relationship with. You know them, they know you, you like them, they like you. And now we can have a good conversation about raising capital. Does that make sense, Alex?
Absolutely, absolutely. And so that's your step number one, correct?
That's most of it. And then The rest of step number one is don't do what Dumb Dumb Dave did and spam everybody with your deals.
And spam from the get-go. No, especially as you said, like, it's people that you know you know, because you have a relationship. Relationship need to be built and maintained. And a lot of people forget about that.
Right. So what I've found that's worked really well, because we do this with our clients, Axel, what I find works really well is just a very simple little 3-email sequence, right? So we want to get, ideally, we want to get a couple hundred people on our target group. We want to have names and email addresses, and then that way we can communicate with them efficiently, right? So we send out 3 different emails, very kind of, you know, informal, catching people up on what you've been up to. So the first email that we send out is just a nice newsy little, hey, it's been a while since we've connected. Here's what I've been up to. Here's what the family's up to. Here's what the kids are doing. Here's the trips I've been taking. Here's the good stuff. Here's the not so good stuff. And how about you? How are you doing? Please hit reply to this email. I'd love to reconnect. So that's the first kick. Second one, 3 or 4 days after that, similar message, but do it a short video, 2 or 3 minutes long, send out a video message. It's just a lot more personal. And then here's the magic. The third message, I call this the transition message. And this is where we give people the heads up that we're going to A, keep in touch with them, and B, we're going to switch gears and start talking about real estate investing. And who knows, you might even be interested in partnering up with me on a deal sometime in the future. So we set the stage for now having the right to go out and communicate with them more often. Yeah. Does that make sense, Axel?
Absolutely. And get their permission. And I don't know if you do it at that stage, but once I've been able to have the real estate conversation with people and say, you know, I do several deals a year. Like, you know, if you'd be interested into hearing about it, would it be okay for me to contact you, let's say, you know, 3-4 times a year when I have a deal, and then you can let me know what you think of it, or you may know people who might be interested.
Well, I do it slightly differently. Mm-hmm. And I like that idea. What I do is just a little bit of a twist on that. And instead, because that's a very overt, hey, when I've got a deal, I'm going to send you all the info. We don't even know if they're interested yet, right?
Yeah.
So what I like to do instead, Axel, is I like to send out a much more regular schedule of communications with them. So instead of 3 or 4 times a year, I'm going to send them something once a week. You know, 1 week, it might be a short little blog post.
Yeah.
Hey, here's some great stuff about real estate investing. Oh, by the way, if you're interested in finding out how to do this passively, click here. Let's have a call. Mm-hmm. So I put the ball in their court.
Yeah.
And again, this is how we're able to get them to come to us requesting the information. That's a complete 180 from us pushing it on that. But maybe 1 week it's a blog post, another week it's an e-zine, another week it's a video log, then maybe another blog post. So just kind of drip, drip, drip with what I call a constant, consistent, edutaining communication. A little bit educational, not too much.
I like it.
Hopefully a little bit entertaining, and just on a regular basis. So they always think, you know, so for example, actually, you're doing this and you're sending this out to your list. They're going to be thinking, yeah, Axel, he's the real estate guy. If I'm interested in doing real estate deals, he's the guy I need to talk to, right? So that's, we want to get top of mind with them, and then we want to stay there with that constant, consistent communication. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So next part of the process, so we got that list, and some of this kind of all happens together, right? It all happens. It's not dung, dung, dung. Some of it all happens.
Of course.
So you get going with that marketing that we were talking about, right? And then we want to make sure we're really good to go when somebody does put up their hand and says, hey, Axel, I'm interested. Tell me about your deals. Then it's not like, oh, crap, now what?
So someone wants to know more. What do I do now?
Yeah. And this is just my personal opinion, right? Like, I find it very, very difficult to explain a deal over the phone unless it's another real estate, excuse the term, weirdo like me. Like you and I, and I say this with love and affection, you and I and your listeners, we are real estate weirdos. You know this already, right? Because when you talk to a non-real estate person about deals, their eyes roll back in the back of their head. They clue out. They don't get it. So here's what we need to remember, Axel. Out of that target group of a couple of hundred people, the vast, vast, vast majority of them are not real estate enthusiasts like we are. They're normal, average Joe Schmo people, which is fine, right?
Yep.
So what I find works best to be able to explain what I'm doing with real estate to somebody like that is a very clear slideshow presentation, like a PowerPoint or a keynote. And here's the trick. And if your listeners or viewers are taking down notes, take this down. Reader's Digest level. I don't know if you're familiar with the old magazine with Reader's Digest. It's written for grownups. However, it's written at a 13-year-old reader's level, right? So any average 13-year-old can pick up that magazine and understand everything in it.
Yeah, that's very well said.
Same idea for our presentation and all of our communications. Mm-hmm. Keep them all that way, right? Because there's a big tendency just to go overboard with data and statistics.
And terms and acronyms
jargon and all this stuff. It just kind of, it makes us sound smart, but, you know.
Completely.
Makes the other first person feel stupid. Nobody likes feeling stupid, right? So let's keep it super simple. Reader's Digest level. Same thing with our presentation. And then we can walk the person through the presentation and show them exactly what it's all about and then see if they'd like to get involved with a deal. And my whole thing is about being very low key, no pressure, right?
Yeah.
At the end of the presentation, if they're not, I give them permission right up front. Hey, if this isn't a good fit for you, let me know ahead of time. That's
absolutely
no at the end.
Yeah.
There's no pressure here. So we'll go through a nice presentation like that. So that's step number two, is really make sure you've got that dialed in. Step number three, we already talked about, is having that marketing, that constant, consistent, edutaining communication going out on a regular basis. And then step number four, or part four of this whole process, is being seen as a credible real estate authority. You want to become 200 famous.
What do you mean by that?
What I mean by that, Axel, is remember that target group of a couple hundred people that we got? Those are the only ones we really care about, right? We don't need to become the next Robert Kiyosaki with a 8 gazillion copies of our book sold or anything like that. Don't even have to have a podcast like you do, which is an amazing platform, an amazing, wonderful platform. But really, for people that are just getting started with raising capital, focus on becoming famous, on becoming the real estate authority in the eyes of those 200 people. Right. Yeah. So different tips and tricks about that. One, a really good way to do it is just dress professionally when you're meeting with somebody and talking about money. Right. Yeah. So if you're having a coffee meeting with somebody, you're going to show them your presentation, dress up, you know, guys, put on the blazer, nice slacks. Nice
be professional.
Be professional. Exactly. Yeah. Even if you're doing it on Zoom, throw the blazer on, look sharp, have the meeting on Zoom. Right. It's going to give the other person respect. And it's going to get you respect back from them as well. Professional material. So have a really good looking investor focused website, a professional looking website, sharp looking business cards go a long way. All of these different, your marketing materials, that goes a long way to making you look like a professional. And again, we're really just focusing on that target group of a couple of hundred people.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
All right. And then last but not least, this is the fun part, Axel, because once you get going, once even you've got your first investor on board and things are going well with that investor, it's so much easier to get more of them by starting the snowball effect. And that means getting warm referrals to their friends and family, because people with money tend to hang out with other people with money, and also getting warm testimonials, ideally video testimonials. So, you know, what we say about ourselves has so much effect. However, what other people say about us has at least 10 times more effect than us pounding our chest talking about how great we are. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Just going back to what you said about referrals, like, it's amazing how exactly as you said, like, you may be partnering with someone and then he'll call you 3 days later and be like, you know, I talked about it with two colleagues, like they want in as well and they could put 100K each. And all of a sudden you're like, oh my God, thank you so much. Like, you just simplified my life. And so, but by putting the proper image of yourself out there and going back to, you know, they have to like you, they have to know you, they have to trust you. You know, obviously working with people that already have two of the elements makes your life so much easier, but then let that person help you in that role, or in that role of access to others, because it goes such a long way.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. That's where the magic really starts, and that's where things start to snowball.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's the five steps in a nutshell there, Axel. So, and again, my whole philosophy is, I got a couple of big picture ideas. Number one, when it comes to which comes first, the chicken or the egg, the deal or the money? The money always comes first. So what we want to do, our goal is, let's get our investor ducks in a row, yeah. Right? So we've got a number of people who have said, yeah, Axel, you know what? When you've got a deal, I want first dibs. I want in. That's about having these investor meetings, mm-hmm. getting people, if they're interested, to sign off on an expression of interest or a letter of intent, something like that. So you know they're pretty interested.
Yeah.
And then the other concept is never stop, right? This is not something that you should be doing in fits and starts. You should get this process up and going, and you should continually be doing this. This is how you really start to grow your business. Back, I was just talking to the gentleman before you and I jumped on Zoom here today, and he's got 14 new joint venture partners this year alone. Again, why? Because of the constant, consistent communications. Yeah. Edutaining communication that's always going out, and he's always having these investor conversations. If he just waited until he had a deal on the go and then chased after the money, there's no way that he'd be able to do this.
No.
So he's got four projects on the go right now.
And it, as you said, it's totally the snowball effect, because the minute you start to push a little bit in one direction, it'll help you in the other. And like several deals that I've been working on now, I spoke to a lot of people about the deal, giving the opportunity for people to invest. And then literally like 2-3 weeks later, something else came up. And then through a friendly conversation, I was like, hey, you know, if this deal isn't for you, this came up, and they jumped on board. I didn't even have to do anything, because they saw through the first presentation and the professionalism and the approach that it's credible, it's serious, it's rather large, and it's going to be successful. And so they were sold, and it make it so much easier. Actually, to a guy now who's like, hey, you know what, Excel, how about you let me raise money for this? I want in. I was like, oh, okay, let's make it work.
Okay.
Okay, let's do it. Let's
do
it.
Yeah. You insist on bringing the capital, I'll take it. Yeah, for sure.
The thing is that all the steps that you've mentioned, I mean, congratulations on coming up with that. But when you think about it, it's not rocket science. It's just that you've learned the hard way through trial and error, whereas you said you turned off a lot of people because you almost went too aggressively up, not, and you hadn't rebuilt a bond. But the thing is that, as you grow, you have to become more organized. And the more organized you become, then the more institutional it seems. And I've had the best success in very personal situations. And that's at a friend's barbecue. And then you're talking, hey, what are you up to? Oh, you're doing some real estate deals and stuff. And then it's your friend of the friend of the friend of the friend who's like, hey, next time, hit me up, you know? And you're like, I didn't even come after you. And so exactly. I find it's the balance of trying to formalize it and putting systems in place, but still remaining very personal.
Well, that's an awesome point there, Axel. And again, well, obviously I spend a full day with people in workshops and stuff teaching this in depth, but that's a really good point, because that target group of prospective investors is not static. It's something that's growing. So
yeah.
When you meet that new acquaintance, that new friend, say, who says, hey, when you got a deal, let me know. And say, hey, great, no problem. How about this? How about if I get your contact information? Mm-hmm. I'm sending out info on a regular basis. Would you like me to add you to my list?
Yeah.
If I say yes, bang. That's how you, plus, you know, you've got a really good website. You know, your investors start talking about you. People are going to do some due diligence before they reach out. Send them to your website. Give them a reason to opt in to get something of value. Then that's how you're going to organically mm-hmm. be growing your sphere of influence.
And I'd be interested in hearing your perspective on this, because on sometimes those occasions of present, you know, informally presenting, or sometimes I'll talk about a deal that we're working on now or something that we finished recently. And I always like to take the time to say, you know, it turned out well, you know, this is what we ended up doing. Here is the outcome, but here's what I would have done differently, because people respect the, I don't even know how to say it. Respect the fact, the honesty, and be like, I kind of screwed up on this. I should have done it this way. I'll know for next time. Because, because what people see as vulnerability is actually a huge strength.
Most definitely. That's one of my favorite things to do within that presentation. Like when I'm having a meeting with somebody, we're going through this slideshow presentation I was telling you about. At the end, I like to come up with, frequently asked questions kind of thing. And here's the big mistake a lot of people make, Axel, is they pretend like there's no downside to a deal. And I go the exact opposite. I go out and say, okay, here are the worst case scenarios. Or I think of what are the worst case scenarios that anybody could think of? And instead of trying to avoid them, hit them straight on.
Yeah. Be open about it.
Well, yeah, because you got to think about it. If somebody's investing with you, what's the worst case scenario they can think of? And one might be, hey, Axel, I'm excited about investing with you, but dude, or let's say you're my prospective investor. Say, hey, Dave, I'm excited about investing with you, but dude, what happens if I get into this deal and you get hit by a bus and you are dead?
Yeah.
What happens then? Or you develop a cocaine habit and move back to Costa Rica. What happens to my money then?
Yeah.
So I actually do it tongue in cheek like that. Have a little bit of fun with it and just say, Dave, what happens if we get this going and a tenant from hell trashes the place? I've always heard all these stories about tenants from hell. What happens if we're in a real estate bubble? I mean, the prices have just been going up so crazy. Mm-hmm. What if it all comes crashing down like it did in the States? And now if you address those issues right up front.
Directly,
It's that honesty, right? Yeah. It's that vulnerability. You say, hey, now don't just, and what I'd like to do with those, I address them and I show them, okay, hopefully it doesn't happen. If that were to happen, here are the contingencies.
Or exactly. Here's
how we would deal with it, right?
Yeah.
Just leave them hanging. But yeah, that's a really good point. Another tip there, Axel, while we're on there, just a big tip for your viewers. If you are putting a presentation together, when you're featuring a deal, our temptation is to take our best deal ever and feature that because that's our baby. That's the one we're most proud of.
Yeah.
Right? Big mistake. Big mistake.
Because you set an expectation.
You do. Two reasons. You set an first of all, the returns you got on that smoking deal are beyond the comprehension of average people. Average people are accustomed to making nothing on their investments. 2-4%. 4% would be like, ooh, I'm a rock star. You start showing people triple digit returns or high double digit returns or the 30-40%, which is completely doable, right? Their bullshit meter is going to go right off, right off the tracks. They're going to say, that's way too good to be true. There's no way this guy's BSing me, right? Or just like you said, if they do believe you, then now you have set that expectation up so high that even if you do a good job, you're probably not going to hit that home run again.
Exactly.
And you're going to look like a schmuck. So what we do instead is take a plain Jane deal as an example, something that got decent returns, but nothing spectacular, show that. And then people are kind of have that expectation and then do your best to exceed it. And then you're going to look like a freaking hero.
Exactly. And that's a friend working on a book who had told me this is like, and he point blank told me like, when I work with clients, I'd much rather undersell and over deliver. And he's like, too many people, they promise on things they don't necessarily control. And then they're the ones who look like the fool. Just say you'll do 20%. And if you give the guy 30, you're a genius.
I would say don't even tell them 20%. Average people, if you're showing people 8, 9, 10, maybe 11% is still starting to stretch the realm of reality for average investors.
Yeah.
Right. So if you might even have to massage your mediocre deal down a bit.
Seriously. The irony and all that.
Is it right?
Yeah.
Massage it down a little bit and say, hey, this was an okay deal. Our investors got 11, 12%. Meanwhile, the non-real estate person that's looking at us going, I've never gotten 11, 12%. That would be freaking awesome. Then you get them 18. Then you got a mediocre deal. You get them 18, 19%, 20%. Yeah. Axel's a rock god.
Yeah.
There's nowhere else I'm going to invest my money. I'm going to tell everybody I know about it.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And it's interesting having these conversations because that's where you learn you know, so much about, as you said, like you'll usually want to show your shiniest and your best deal, but you're actually making yourself a disfavor. It's a very good point.
And ask me how I learned all these.
Yeah. The hard way. See, I like what you said at the beginning that we're real estate weirdos because we actually like talking about all this stuff.
I'm talking about
it. Yeah.
You got a podcast, for Christ's sake.
I know. But lately I've noticed that even with the podcast, it's sometimes a little bit less about real estate, but a lot more just about general psychology, whether it's transactional, whether it's negotiation, whether it's positioning, yeah, whether it's all that. And it becomes a lot more about just the mindset than the actual, like, you know, how to crunch a deal or something like that.
Well, yeah, I mean, you can, anybody can Google that kind of stuff and find it lickety split. Yeah, this is the good stuff.
Excellent. So, Dave, you run a full program teaching how to people how to do this. Like, can you tell us a little bit about it?
Well, yeah, I do 1-day workshops where we have a fairly small group of about 50 people, give or take, and we spend 8 solid hours diving in deep into this and actually getting into the weeds of how to put together your investor list and how to do that whole warm-up campaign, what kind of software you should be using, how to do websites, and how to do your investor presentation and all the marketing, easings, video logs, blogs. You know, we spent 8 solid hours actually doing that, Axel. So if anybody's interested in that, investorattractionworkshop.com is where they can check that out. But otherwise, if you just kind of want to dip your toe into the water, I do have a book that I put together called The Money Partner Formula. And if your viewers or listeners are interested in getting a complimentary copy of that, I'll trade it to them for their name and their email address. Is that fair?
Sounds like a plan. I'll put it in the show notes.
All right. Or they could just go to investorattractionbook.com. Axel, I have spared no time or expense putting together this.
I know, I love it.
Time for you. investorattractionbook.com, and they can get a copy of the book there.
Sounds good. Well, I hope they'll come over and knock on your door, because you have a lots to teach and a good track record to show it.
Yeah, not just me, but here's the cool thing. It has worked. I mean, we've been doing this for years with clients, and literally we've got hundreds of people going out there following the process, and it's worked really, really, really well for them. Because they did it right from the beginning. They didn't go out like a bull in a china shop like I did.
Yeah, but sometimes it's the best way to learn. Like, so many things now, like 2 years later, I'm like, oh, I wish I would have known that. But hey, you live and learn, and it is what it is.
Exactly.
Dave, it's been a pleasure. Thank you very much for joining today.
Thank you, Axel. It's been an absolute pleasure, and I wish you and your audience all the best in these exciting new times.
Oh yeah. And then for everyone out there, thank you for listening, and as usual, you know, it only helps. Leave me a little review, send me some feedback. Always love to learn about what you thought, what you would do different. It helps us in getting good guests so we can all learn and find better ways to go about doing good real estate deals. So thank you very much. Have a wonderful day, and talk to you next week. Ciao, ciao.